everybody doing? As Nikki would say, it's a great day in South Carolina. It really is. I hope the weather will stay with us. That's one reason people I talk to from all over the country, they do like the weather in South Carolina. It makes a big difference. Let me start. I've just had a few minutes, but I'll tell you, we have the State of the State coming up tomorrow night. I hope you tune in. I got a lot to say. Not much time to say it. But one thing that I hear from these businesses that come here from other states and particularly from other countries, and I may not have told you, they say that South Carolina is a handshake state. And I've heard the chairman of BMW on their 25th anniversary and other people say the same thing. Arthrex, which started a new surgical tool operation, transferred from Minneapolis, I think, into Florida, and now it's in Anderson, where they're working with Clemson and with the Technical College and Anderson University, which is the new paradigm of how these companies are working, and it's something that's being pioneered here. But he said the same thing, he used the same words, and those men did not collaborate on what they were going to say. He's at different times and different places. He says this is a handshake state. So when people in South Carolina give you their word and shake your hand, they keep it. And they went on, and my questions with them at other times and other executives as well, they say it's just not that way everywhere. Which brings me to realize more strongly than ever before how different we really are in this state and how the great assets that we have. There's no excuse in the world why we can't outrun any other state with business development and growth in South Carolina. There's no reason. One thing is that we're not a small state. We're exactly medium size. Population is exactly medium size. Income and all that is roughly medium size. But what that means is we can turn on a dime. And you know from your work, there's no place, there's no town in the state where you need to talk to somebody about something. You either know the person that you want to talk to or you know somebody that knows the person. That is a great, great advantage that we have that you don't have in other places. Somebody said one time, as a young lawyer, he used to get a lot of odd questions out in the country. And one of them he got, or some of them, many like this, they said, well, lawyer, let me ask you, if we're married in South Carolina and divorced in Georgia, are we still cousins? That's the kind of closeness we have. It's a wonderful thing, and we need to celebrate. But again, our research universities are willing to collaborate. And it's happening. I won't try to list all those collaborations, but they're marvelous. The companies coming here that are not going anywhere else, and they're entering into these partnerships with the academia and industry, and it's going to produce results that are hard to imagine where it's going to all lead. But we're all running into some bumps in the road. Samsung came, it's a great company. We were unable to convince the people in Washington that they should not have a tariff placed on that for the next 3 years on the washing machines that they're bringing in while they're starting the production in Newberry. I thought it was a bad decision. I told them so. I went up and testified and argued, but the facts unfortunately did not win the day. But there's always another day, and that's gonna make things a little tougher on Samsung than they were expecting. But you ought to see that plant. You ought to see that thing. It is a marvel. What they're doing in there. It is high tech. The people are so happy to have their jobs, those jobs. And again, Samsung is going off the scale in this new paradigm. They are collaborating with Clemson University, the University of South Carolina, and the Technical College to put all those talents and all those abilities together. And in one place, at Clemson, they have a manufacturing excellence, advanced manufacturing, I don't remember the name of it, it's right there by ICAR, and it is off the scale. It is the only place in the country, and possibly in the world, where you have PhDs that are teaching at Clemson, and you have master's candidates, PhD candidates, bachelor's candidates, technical college students, and high school students, all working shoulder to shoulder with those that know this, teaching those that know that, as a team working on, for example, BMW vehicles, which by the way, they produce one every 61.7 seconds in Greer, South Carolina. It's off the scale. But that's the only place in the country, and perhaps in the world, where you have all that brain power the youthful and the experienced working on these vehicles. They strip them down, they leave whatever components in, and they invent new things to make them work better. And it's phenomenal to see. But that's what's going on here. So what we have to do, what I see my job is be sure that we don't mess it up. Be sure that we keep the door open, we help those companies, and we just show them what we have here in South Carolina. We're not going to get them all, but we're going to get more than our share because we can provide things they can't get anywhere else, including the Port of Charleston, including two inland ports, all of those things, and the weather that I mentioned before, and the people. But there are a number of things that I think we have to do to keep our competitive advantage. One of them is we've got to cut taxes. I agree with Ronald Reagan, I agree with Jack Kennedy, and I agree with Donald Trump. The way to spur economic growth is to cut taxes. So what I have suggested and I've asked the legislature to do is cut them by 1%, the income tax. Cut it by 1%. It's 7%. The top one is 7%. Cut them all down, 1% over 5 years. What that'll do is reduce $2.2 billion. That's a lot of money. There's more money than that in the economy, but those things add up. So do those little taxes, whether it's sales taxes, fees, all that, they add up to stop the economy. We've got to cut those taxes. In the first year, that'll keep $139 million in the pockets of the people out there that work. And over 5 years, it's $2.2 billion. Another thing I'm asking the legislature to do is to eliminate taxes, income taxes, on retirement pay for a whole group of people. And that is military veterans, law enforcement officers, peace officers, those are people, these are commissioned people that work in the prisons, EMS personnel, all those that are working for the government, when they get a retirement package, retirement pay, eliminate the income tax on that. What'll that do? One thing, we don't have the money to pay everybody what we would like to pay them. And it's like we have the man in a 6-foot bed with a 4-foot blanket. It will never be enough money to pay everybody and do all the things that we want to do. So we have to find other ways to do it. This is one way to do that. This will help recruitment. It will help retention in those areas. And also it will help those people just a little bit in their retirement years. And it keeps those kind of people active and healthy in our community. We got to work on schools. I think I'm about to run out of time, but there are two pillars of prosperity, and that is workforce development and education. And if you got one and you got the other, you're walking around in circles on one leg. I have gone through the Abbeville cases, the Abbeville case, the schools that are mentioned there, and it's clear as a bell to me. There's no secret. If you got good teachers and you've got good principals, you can have a good school and you can teach children, but you've got to have the very best teachers, you've got to have the very best principals. We got one here, it's Akeel Ross, he's at Chapin High School. He's the 2017 National Principal of the Year in America. And we've had three in, I think, about the last 12 years. We've got the talent, but we have a system with bloated bureaucracies in the district offices. We've got some school districts that have one school, but they have an administrative staff and function the same size as some of the larger ones. We need to combine some of those. We also need to see that our charter schools, these are all public schools. We have a state charter school district. And we have two authorizers now, the state district and also Erskine College. We need to get those charter schools through that authorized and let them go out there and start providing the special kind of schools that some children need in order to progress. And I'm a big believer in school choice. I'm also a big believer in the traditional public education. We got to have both. You got to have as many kinds of education as necessary to be sure that the children get that education. So I'm working on that as well, and I appreciate your advice. On regulations, we got too many of them. Y'all have run into them yourselves, but getting permits and being permitted for construction work. You got to get 99 permits in order to work in one place sometime. We got to change all that. But all it takes is an open mind and an idea, and we can bring it all together. So that's my story. There's a lot more I'd like to tell you, and I'll have a chance if you want some real exciting television, watch tomorrow. Probably love it. But it will be. It's a great present ideas and get things started. On electricity, we've got a little bump in the road with Scanlon and Santee Cooper. Santee Cooper has been a government power company for 83 years. I think that's long enough. And I think also that I'm convinced that there's no way that Santee Cooper right now has $8 billion in debt. About $4.3 billion for these reactors that are never going to be built, apparently. That means those ratepayers, those customers, have put in haven't put it all in yet because they would have to still pay, but they're putting in that much money for reactors that are not going to produce an ounce of electricity that can be sold to get money to pay those bonds off. So we got a big hole in the budget right there. The only way to get out of it is to sell it. And the good news is that people want to buy it. Their companies, they're coming from all over the place. Some even from foreign countries that are interested. And so I'm working on that. I think that's the only way that we can get, but it'll be a good sale. It's a very valuable asset, but it'll be a step forward once we do that. The good news in all this interest from these countries and these companies in this debacle that we've had with Santee Cooper and Scanlon is that there is interest all over the place, all over the country and in other countries in South Carolina. Everybody wants to come to South Carolina because they see it as the future, as the most promising place to be for economic growth and development. And ladies and gentlemen, finally, if you have economic growth and development, I'm for bigger, more paychecks, bigger paychecks, and more of them. If you have growth, economic development, and prosperity, a lot of the things that hold us down, a lot of the things that cause misery, go away. I'm talking about a lot of drug usage, domestic violence, a whole lot of things. You have more marriages, less divorces, better education, everything. When you have economic growth and development, a lot of problems just go to the wayside. So that's if we have good education, strong, imaginative education, and we keep our workforce developed, we've got programs, too many to mention here, where we're going to be trying to get people. We've got 60,000 jobs out there right now, good paying jobs, looking for people. 60,000 jobs paying. These are in the trades, truck drivers, all kind of technicians, and these big plants, they don't carry toolboxes anymore. They carry laptops and tablets, and they could go in there dressed in tuxedos and wouldn't even get dirty. It's a different kind of economy going on. But as long as we focus on those important things and don't get distracted, don't get caught up in the little things, we will be in very good shape. So that's the way I see it. And it's a good thing to see. And I'll tell you this also, I'm proud of South Carolina. I'm proud of all the people. I'm proud of what we've done over the years, what we've endured, the ups and downs. We're still here. And right now, I tell you, it is our time. It is our time. There's not another state that can come close to competing economically with us right now. And y'all are in the middle of it. So I'm going to mess it up. Y'all will mess it up.